The date is January 30th, 1997. Survivor, Kurt Lewin. Interviewer, Naomi Rappaport. The city is New York. The state, New York. The country, USA. Language, English. My name is Naomi Rappaport, N-A-O-M-I-R-A-P-P-A-P-O-R-T, and today is January 30th, 1997. I am conducting an interview with Mr. Kurt Lewin in New York, New York, USA. Good morning, Mr. Lewin.
Good morning, Mrs. Rappaport.
And thank you very much for welcoming us to your home and sharing your testimony with the Shoah Foundation. We would like to start with your name. Could you give us your name and spell it, please?
My name is Kurt, K-U-R-T, Lewin, L-E-W-I-N.
And what was your name at birth?
My name at birth was the same, but my middle name was Isaac, or in Hebrew, Yitzhak.
Could you spell both Isaac and Yitzhak?
It would be I-S-A-A-C or Y-I-T, like in Thomas, Z-H-A-K.
Did you have any other names?
Yes. I lived under assumed names as a Ukrainian after my escape from the ghetto, as Roman or Roman Mitka.
Could you spell that, please?
R like Robert, O M like in Mary, A N. Mitka, M like in Mary, Y T like in Thomas, K A. After moving on to Lublin, to the liberated part of Poland by the Red Army, because of anti-Semitism and killing of Jews, I assumed a Polish name. I kept the same first name, which was Roman, but I used the name Matkowski, which is M-A-T, like in Thomas, K-O-W-S-K-I. And under this name, I served at the end of the Second World War in the Polish Army.
Any other names?
No.
Nicknames?
No.
Your birth date?
I was born on February 28, 1925.
And how old are you, sir?
I am 71 years old, and another few weeks, I will be 72.
And where were you born? In what city?
I was born in Katowice in Silesia.
And how do you spell Katowice?
K-A-T, like in Thomas, O-W-I. C-E.
And Silesia was what country?
That is a complicated question, because Silesia is on the borderline of Poland and Germany. At certain times, it was Germany. At other times, it was Poland.
When you were born, what was it?
It was Poland.
Thank you. Did your family always live in Katowice?
No.
Where did they come from?
Originally, the family started in Amsterdam, according to my knowledge. I come from a rabbinical family, and most of my ancestors were rabbis, and they moved from place to place according to the rabbinical chair which they occupied at a given time.
So who was the rabbi in Katowice?
My father.
And his name, please?
Dr. Ezekiel Lewin, after taking his PhD at the Jagiellon University in Krakow and completing his rabbinical studies, was ordained as an Orthodox rabbi, and his first rabbinical chair which he occupied was Katowice.
What do you remember about Katowice?
Very little. I was a child. I left Katowice when I was about 3 years old. So my memories are rather vague.
Where did you move to?
I moved with my parents to Lwów. I pronounce the name of the city in Polish. It would be probably useful if I will indicate that the city in Polish is Lwów. In German, it is Lemberg. In Russian, it is Lwów. In Ukrainian, it is Lviv.
How do you spell Lviv?
Lviv would be spelled L, V, like in Victor, I, W. That's the way it's spelled and pronounced, but in Ukrainian.
Do you remember the move at all?
Oh, yes.
What do you recall? How did you
Well, I have
get there?
Very few recollections from Katowice as a child, but I distinctly remember my father being greeted by the community in Katowice, and quite a number of people who came to the railroad station to say goodbye to my parents.
Where did you live in Lwów?
I lived in Lwów on a street called Trzeciego Maja, 3rd of May, number 7.
What was the 3rd of May celebrating?
It is the day where the Polish Sejm, an equivalent of Congress, has accepted formally a constitution, a new constitution, which is called the Constitution of 3rd of May, and it is modeled somewhat on the American Constitution, really.
You know the year, the 3rd of May?
You caught me, but I would assume it's 1796 or 95.
What kind of house did you live in? A dwelling?
I lived in an apartment house, which was built probably at the turn of the century, as Lwów was an administrative center of Austro-Hungary, of southern Poland. It was a house quite similar to the ones you will find in Vienna, or equivalent of Park Avenue in New York.
Were there many rooms?
Yes, my father had his office there, his library, and there were living quarters. To my recollection, there were about 7 rooms.
And who lived there?
My father, my mother, my younger brother was born there at the time when we lived in Lwów, and shortly after we arrived, and my youngest brother, who was born a few years later. So this was the family.
Did you have help?
Yes.
That lived there?
Yes. We had, first of all, a housekeeper and a nanny for the children. And in addition, every morning, the secretary of my father, who was provided by the Jewish community, used to come and be there during office hours, equivalent of 9 to 5.
The synagogue of which your father was a rabbi, what kind of synagogue was it?
That's a very difficult question. The question, because the tendency would be to relate it to the Jewish theological structure here in the United States, which is Orthodox, conservative, and Reformed. It was neither. But after the Haskalah, there were movements in the Jewish community in Germany and in Austria, which eventually spilled into Poland, to adapt the form of worship to different times, namely to the emancipation of Jews and no longer existence in ghettos. You had in Vienna this movement, in Leipzig, in Frankfurt, and they called it enlightened movement or progressive movement. In fact, these were Orthodox congregations, but with a more formal form of worship. And they were worshiping in what they referred to temples. The community in Katowice was German-oriented, and therefore it was a reflection of the same movement in Germany. The community in Lwów was more Vienna-oriented and reflected the same movement in Vienna. My father was an Orthodox rabbi.
What was the relationship, if you know, or did you have anything to do with the Hasidic movement at all in Lwów?
Oh, yes. I didn't have any direct relationship with the Hasidic movement, but I'm aware what it was. Hasidic movements stem from the days of Baal Shem Tov. They were perverted, and I use my word specifically and not by accident, by subsequent evolution of Jewish sects which were headed by dynastic rabbinical families like Ger, Belz, Satmar, and there were Komarna, Bobor, many, many.
But were they also in Lwów as well?
Yes, they were everywhere. But they were basically a minority.
Did you relate to them at all? You and your father?
The relationship was friendly, and the relationship was somewhat delicate because my family was a family of mitnagdim. I don't wish to go into a lengthy discussion what mitnagdim means. And this was a predominant trend in the Jewish community in Poland and in Lithuania.
How was your father dressed?
Well, that's a good question. My father wore what was referred to in Austria, Schlussrock.
What does that mean?
This was a suit with pants, but a three-quarter jacket, double-breasted.
Was that a rabbinical
It is
outfit?
Not a rabbinical outfit, because rabbis, you see, in Orthodox community wore a chalat. This was a Western, but it was three-quarters.
Did he wear a hat?
Always, yes, and yarmulke, always. A yarmulke at home, but a hat on the street, no question about it.
And your mother, did she have her head covered?
She would wear a hat. My mother used to dress in the Western fashion, as most other women did. Certainly not a shaitel, which was considered a barbaric sort of a custom in the community at large.
At home, did she have her head covered, or did
no.
She didn't. And what about you?
Well,
what kind of clothing did you wear?
I wore normal clothing, and I felt as a child quite oppressed by the fact that I was in the public eye. My father was a very prominent man, so I was known and I was observed, and I resented it. I tried not to embarrass my father, but I wouldn't necessarily cover my head unless I was in some public function or so.
What language was spoken in your house?
We spoke in Katowice German, because this was a primarily German Jewish community, and my first language, therefore, was German.
And
in Lwów, I spoke Polish. Most Jews in southern Poland, in places, Krakow, Tarnów, Rzeszów, Lwów, used Polish, and the community spoke a beautiful Polish.
In terms of ritual, Did you attend services every day, every week?
I attended services usually on Saturdays and on holidays. My father attended services every day.
And what holidays were celebrated in
Lewin? The usual cycle of Jewish holidays, which you'll find in every traditional Jewish home.
What was for you the most memorable or holiday? As a child?
As a child, I found the Yamim Noraim, I use a Hebrew expression, which means the New Year's Yom Kippur affair, rather oppressive. And I liked very much the Shloshet HaRegalim, which means the three pilgrimage holidays, Passover, Shavuot, Sukkot.
What about Shabbat?
We had a traditional Saturday at home, which I loved very much. So my father was a prominent man and was under continuous pressure of meetings and duties. So it's only on Friday and Saturday that we have had him to ourselves.
What was Friday night like?
Well, the usual. My father used to come from the synagogue, and as he was Orthodox, he used to put actually a silk halat and a girdle they refer to it, and used to pray and sing the welcoming hymns, which are traditional. Then we had a kiddush.
Did you sing with your father?
Not really. I had little interest in it. Not only that, as I have pointed out, I had a slight resentment because the pressures on me and variety of other things which I experienced in the outside world, so I didn't know where I am. Consequently, I kept relatively neutral, friendly and neutral. I liked the Shabbat because of the atmosphere of the house, which was a traditional, cultivated Jewish home.
Who cooked the Shabbat meal?
The housekeeper. And my mother was a president of many women's organizations and so forth. And the pressures on her were equally great as on my father, because the wife of the rabbi had quite a number of social and duties.
What was the meal? What did the meal consist of?
The meal consisted usually what you would find in every Jewish home in those days, namely gefilte fish and soup and meat and some dessert, and that's it.
Did your father bring anyone home as a guest?
Oh, there was always a guest.
And what kind of guests was he bringing?
There was one guest who was a very strange man, because he was always, on Fridays, invited to the rabbi's house traditionally. So as there were two chief rabbis who shared the rabbinical chair, so one Friday night he spent with one family, and one Friday night with another one. His name was Senator Bodek, Jakub Bodek. And he was a senator, he was elected senator, representing the Jewish community in the Polish Sejm, or Senate, which is an equivalent of the Congress. He was the director of the railroad district for the Austro-Hungarian government. He was engaged to a young lady who died very shortly before the wedding. And the man dedicated his life to charity. And all his life he remained single, and just simply addressed himself to servicing the poor and the people in need. And therefore, traditionally, the rabbis greeted him on Friday, and he was always a guest either at my father's home or the other rabbi.
Before we leave the food issue, who did the shopping, your mother or the housekeeper?
Oh, the housekeeper. My and mother was too busy.
Who kept track of the kashrut? The housekeeper or
the
mother?
That is my mother. I have to stress that my father was an Orthodox rabbi, and consequently, all the restrictions and way of life which you would find in any Jewish Orthodox home were present in my home. No question about it.
Which were for you the most difficult restrictions?
The restrictions of kashrut and things like that didn't bother me too much. I just had to behave in a way, in a fashion that people wouldn't come to my father saying that I'm behaving like a gentle child and get into fights and things of that sort.
What was your family considered economically?
What do you mean by that?
Middle class, wealthy?
Position of a rabbi in the old world was entirely different than it is here in the United States. These people were lawgivers. They administered law because Jews refrained from going to courts. They were spiritual leaders of the community and very highly regarded and respected. Rarely, if ever, they were paid a very generous salary. So their lifestyle was relatively modest. My impression is, as my father was a chief rabbi of a very large, very wealthy community, he was paid, looking at it from my perspective today, adequately. We are not in a need. But my impression is that we could not afford too many luxuries. However, my mother was rather wealthy because her father was an estate owner, very large estate.
The street on which you lived, was that a residential area? Or
primarily residential.
And where did you go to school?
Well, I went first to a public school in Lwów, and the public school system, which was left over by Austro-Hungary, was excellent. And the school's name was Adam Mickiewicz, a very famous Polish writer and poet, more or less a contemporary of Byron and Pushkin. That was a very fine school. There I finished sixth grade.
Were there a lot of Jewish children in there?
This composition of the city has, in a way, determined the composition of children in the school. One-third was Jewish, one-third was Polish, and one-third was Ruthenian or Ukrainian.
And was it co-ed? Were there girls in the classes as well?
No.
How about the staff, the teachers? Were they all Polish or all divided
Polish.
That way too?
Polish primarily.
Did you have any Jewish teachers at all?
No. Jews were teaching in some schools, but it was not common to see many Jewish teachers in the public school system.
What was your relationship with your fellow students?
I was a curiosity because, first of all, my father was a leader of men and leader of the community and well-known in Jewish and non-Jewish circles. Secondly, because of the position of my father, I did not attend school on Saturdays, which in a way was a handicap because all through my schooling I missed Saturdays. I was not a very good student. And I was always observed. So my memories are mixed.
By whom?
By the teachers and other students. Because being my father's son, I was expected to perform competent and remarkable way, which I was unable to end the story.
What about the social relationship with the other children?
After religion was introduced to the curriculum in the second grade, the Roman Catholics were instructed by a Roman Catholic priest, the Ruthenian by a Greek Catholic priest, and the Jews by a teacher of religion. So, the minute religion was introduced, you had first signs of anti-Semitism and friction between the kids. The Poles, antagonistic toward the Ruthenians, who were Greek Catholic, Byzantine Catholics, and both against Jews.
How did that manifest itself?
Fights, very simple.
Do you recall any personal experiences?
Oh, many, but it's a long story and frankly not interesting, because this was a way of life. A Jew had to defend himself or be beaten up.
Were you beaten up?
No. Because I used to beat up others. I was rather a scrappy little boy and knew how to defend myself. And occasionally I ran into difficulties, but I was exposed to anti-Semitism and direct attacks since the age of probably 8. It's a way of life.
Did you have any kind of social relationship that the boys played together?
Boys played together, yes.
Jewish boys, yes. But what about the non-Jewish children?
After the introduction of religion, it ended.
What did you do on a recess when you had a break?
The usual, played ball.
With whom?
With boys, and we used to go to the park. And the normal land is to wander through the city, which is very interesting, because very beautiful city. There's many things to offer. And that's all I can tell you. It's nothing unusual.
Did you ever visit the homes of non-Jewish children?
Until religion was introduced.
And you were about 8 then?
8, yeah.
Did they ever come to your house?
Yes.
Before or after?
After, no. You see, the introduction of religion has immediately segregated the children and introduced barriers.
Did you go to cheder too, did you have a Hebrew education?
Yes,
as well?
My father tried very hard to arrange for me Hebrew religious education, but I did not respond to it, and finally, my father, being a very intelligent man, realized that by forcing me, he will only increase the resentment. The result was that I had no religious education. I was free.
Did you have a bar mitzvah?
Oh, yes. No question about it.
Who trained you?
Oh, I was trained by a very pleasant young teacher. And I could sing my parsha. And
do you remember the parsha?
It's somewhere at the end of February. But I couldn't tell you. I don't remember any longer. But I read the Haftorah, and I also read from the Torah, which I still am able occasionally to do. And then there was a reception in my house, and I delivered a discourse on tefillin. Namely, there are, as you know, the Rabbeinu Tam's tefillin and Rashi's tefillin.
We're going to have to change our tape now.
Oh, by all means.
take number two, interview with Mr. Kurt Lewin. We were talking about your bar mitzvah. Who came to the bar mitzvah reception?
There were almost 100 people. There were the leaders of the community and their wives. And that was a very major event. And my presentation, or my drasha, was taken from a topic which was introduced by my great-grandfather, after whom I am named, Beit Yitzchak, or in Jewish, Reb Yitzchok Shmelkes, who was the Orthodox rabbi of Lviv at the turn of the century.
Amongst your parents' friends, were there non-Jews as well?
No. My father had some friends at the university, because he was interested in Greek and Latin literature and classics. So he had some friends. Also, he had many contacts with the non-Jewish community. He was very highly regarded. But it was not common to have too many relations with non-Jews. The only contact which he had was with Archbishop Andrew Graf Shetitsky, because of circumstances which existed in Lviv. Namely, it was a very prominent man who celebrated his 70th birthday. And when my father read that the Roman Catholic clergy ignored it, although he was a Roman Catholic archbishop, a Greek Catholic archbishop, not Roman Catholic. So my father headed a delegation to greet the man in the name of the Jewish community, because he was very friendly, very correct toward the Jewish community, and usually also made contributions to charitable causes. There's evidence of it.
In your home, we're talking about your bar mitzvah in 1938.
Yes.
In your home, were you aware, were there newspapers, radio, of what was going on in Germany, Hitler, Nazism?
Oh, yes, so, no question about it.
What were people thinking of leaving? Had your family discussed leaving Europe?
That's a very complicated question, because, you see, people didn't have the knowledge which they have today. Secondly, they didn't fully comprehend the depth of the hatred which was cultivated by the leaders of the Third Reich. And the danger came from two areas. First of all, from the red terror which was unfolding in USSR, and Hitler's activity and his government's activities in Germany. But I was aware of it because it was discussed at home, and the newspapers brought news of expulsion of Jews from Germany to Poland. Namely, very many Jews of Polish origin emigrated to Germany in the 20s. Lived in a variety of cities, and they had to leave, and they were kept in a place, Bonschen, actually not far from Katowice, for months before they were released into Poland. So all this was permeating my life as a teenager.
Did you meet any of these German, Polish, Jewish?
No, indirectly. No, I had little. I lived in a sort of a cocoon of a teenager going to school. However, the discussion whether to leave was always there. My father was a Zionist, one of the few Orthodox rabbis who openly accepted and supported Zionism. He was actually a member of the executive committee in southern Poland. He was the president of Keren Kayemet, He was the president of Keren Hayesot. He politically had no affiliation with any specific group, but he supported the emigration to what was then Eretz Israel or Palestine, because this offered a channel of escape. Therefore, he was highly critical of the Hasidic movement and the Orthodoxy, which tried to prevent that, because he saw Poland as a trap.
What about you? Were you a member of any youth groups?
No, I was not interested, and I kept aloof of any political activity. Reason being is that I could always embarrass my father, so I just kept aloof.
What were your interests as a teenager?
Horses. Girls.
Where did you meet girls?
In park, near our house. And I was interested in sports and to squeeze through from grade to grade. There was a shame not to be able to move from grade to grade, to be left behind.
Did you do a lot of reading?
Yes, I read an enormous amount.
What was your favorite topic of reading?
History.
History.
Yeah. History, literature.
Amongst young people, was there discussion about what was going on? Were you able to hear radio broadcasts?
Oh, yes, but I don't think we had a clear view, or for that matter, the pressures of studying were such that there was little time left for too much leisure and the introduction of current affairs into schools. It's a product of the United States at a much later date.
Did any of your friends leave the country?
Yes.
Where did they go?
Primarily to Eretz Israel, Palestine, and one or two were sent to schools in England.
Where were you in 1939 when the Germans invaded Poland?
We were at my grandfather's estate for a vacation, where we usually were. And
which is where?
It was near Rawaruska. Mm-hmm. And sometime around August the 20th, which was 2 weeks before we usually used to return to the city, my father, who was in Lwów, sent a cable saying that we should immediately return to the city. So we cut our vacation short, and my mother and the three children, myself and my two brothers, returned by rail, as we usually did, to Lwów. And you could sense the excitement and tension. This was after the Germans have dismembered Czechoslovakia. And eventually there was a mobilization.
Did you see Germans in 1939?
39, no. Because on September 1st they bombed the city, which was no more nor less but act of terror, because there were no military objectives of any kind in Lwów. And secondly, there were no military concentration. It was just an old city, just like bombing Florence, exactly the same. But this barbarism was an opening of a variety of things which happened subsequently. And then the Germans approached Lwów after a few days, and there was a siege. But the Polish garrison defended itself, and rather successfully, until the Red Army crossed the eastern border of Poland, and then it was unclear what will happen next.
I'd just like to go back for one moment. You mentioned you were at your grandfather's estate with your mother and two brothers.
Yes.
What was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Rachel. Family name or maiden name was Reiss, R-E-I-S-S.
And your brother's name?
Nathan was my younger brother, and Leon was my youngest brother.
To get back to 1939, when the German siege ended and the U.S. And the Soviet domination began, when did you first see or feel Soviet domination?
Well, at once, because I don't remember the exact date, but my impression is that sometime in the third week of September, the Polish radio station was still active and providing news. I still remember distinctly playing Chopin music all day long. And then it was cut off like with a knife, and within hours Soviet tanks appeared and Soviet soldiers. And the city was occupied by the Red Army, which was very orderly. They didn't interfere with the local population at all in the first few days. They jumped only at the stores, because the stores were functioning normally, and emptied the shelves. And that's it.
How did your life change when in Soviet domination?
First of all, food. The distribution of food disintegrated, so there was literally hunger. Secondly, it took some time before the flow of water was restored. And then winter came. It was one of the most severe winters in my memory. And we didn't have fuel, so it was very cold. Epidemics developed in the city, a variety of diseases.
Were you sick at all?
Yes, I almost died of diphtheria because there was no serum. And was found with great deal of difficulty. And then this population of the city swelled because of refugees who came from Western Poland. So life, in short, was quite miserable in the first year.
How did it affect your father's position as a rabbi?
Well, I don't know how to approach it, because if we measure it by what we know today and by yardsticks of modern life, I think he perhaps was foolhardy, because he resumed his position and his activities as a rabbi in the temple, just as is nothing before. And the temple was packed every Friday and Saturday. He continued to preach. And regardless of Stalin's terror and activities of the Russians in the city, he carried on.
Were you a victim of any of these sieges or activities?
Oh, yes, in a variety of ways. First of all,
you personally?
Personally, I was persecuted in the school because I was a son of a rabbi, or as they used to say, a Yevreisky pope. Pop.
What is pop mean?
Clergyman. So the new management of the school, which came from the Ukraine, among them also some Jews, were haunting me because I was a counter-revolutionary.
And how did they hound you?
Pardon me?
How did they do this?
Well, there are many ways. You see, there was the atmosphere of paranoia, and it's well described. It was much more severe than what we know about conditions in the Soviet Union, which were described after the war, until even Brezhnev's times. This was the midst of Stalin's terror, and of steroids.
As a young boy, how old were you then, 14, 15?
I was 14, 39.
How did it impact on you?
My father could be arrested any moment.
But you personally?
I personally could be arrested in the school for some counter-revolutionary activities, which was very strange. And secondly, I was pointed out by this consort, which is Komsomolsky organizer, which organizer of the young communists, as an example of somebody who disrupts the school and causes sabotage. Now, these were very dangerous things in those days. because by haunting me, she could provoke arrest of my parents and deportation.
Were you a member of the group?
No.
Did you have to become a member of the group?
I couldn't because of my social background. But as I was reasonably resourceful, I became an instructor of the Red Cross, first aid, because it was non-political. And as a senior instructor, eventually, of the Red Cross, I was meshed into the civil defense system, which was organized by the Russian military. So I became essentially part of the mechanism and out of the clutches of the Comsorg.
Was a typical day for you at that time?
Go to school, the Shetilyetka, 10-year program. That's the name of the school. There was previously a Jewish school, so most of the kids were Jewish. It was gymnasium, which was transformed into a Soviet school. I spent about until 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock at school. And from then on, I had to go to work in my activities as an instructor of the Red Cross.
And that was a typical day.
Yes.
Who were your friends?
Other kids. This time, boys and girls, because the Soviets have commingled a Jewish gymnasium for girls with boys and divided the students so that the classes were co-educational.
And how aware were you of what was going on in the rest of Poland?
Well, we were quite well aware of what was going on in the rest of Poland. We knew that there's a persecution of Jews, but we are not aware of the brutality or anything which would lead us to think that there's an extermination program. We were certainly oppressed by the Soviets, but not to the same extent. There was a semblance of normal life, and after the first year under Soviet occupation, the supply situation has improved somewhat, but and life was more normal, but we were annexed to the Soviet Union, so Lwów became a Soviet administrative center. And on the other hand, this was the start of major arrests and deportations.
Were you able to continue Hebrew studies or religious studies at all?
Well, I wasn't interested in Hebrew studies before the war, so I didn't go out of my way to resume it under the Soviet occupation. I just wasn't too interested in it.
What happened when the Germans came back in? Do you remember that?
Surely I remember that.
Can you describe?
First of all, the city was bombed again by the Germans. And there was heavy fighting, not in the city, but in the surrounding area, for almost a week. And then the Russians started to withdraw and evacuate. There were very many casualties, and as I was in first aid units, so I was going to the places which were bombed out to remove the bodies and help the wounded. It was considerable chaos, and we again lived in a cellar, as we did in 39. Hunger, lack of water, and the usual. The Germans arrived the first day, nothing changed, except that the city was decorated with blue and yellow flags, because the Ukrainians had the illusion that a Ukraine would be created, independent Ukraine, by the Germans. And the second day was still quiet, but then the pogrom started.
How did they start?
Hmm?
How did they start? How did the pogrom start?
That's impossible to answer because...
Well, from what was your first impression of a pogrom?
My father went to the Metropolitan, to Archbishop Szeptycki, a highly influential man, and was actually prepared a few comments in Polish, which I translated for him in Ukrainian, which I had very rudimentary knowledge. And before going there, his barber came to give him a haircut, which was normal at that time. He put on rabbinical clothes and went there in rabbinical garb, accompanied by two senior members of the community. And I said goodbye to my father, and I was lying on a couch and reading a book.
Why was he going?
Because there were rumors that the Ukrainian population is attacking Jews. And consequently, he went to his friend asking for intervention. And after my father left, I just waited for him to come back, and I was lying on the couch reading a book engrossed. I still remember the book. It was one of these Western novels written in the United States in English, translated into Polish. Suddenly, four or five young Ukrainians came in, dragged me out into the street where I was beaten, and dragged into the prison. And I didn't know before I knew what was happening to me, I found myself in the city prison, which was not too far, about a block and a half away.
Were you alone at home? Was your mother home?
My mother was home, but they didn't touch women at that time or children, just men. I was 16 years old, so I was considered already a man.
Now, what did you find in the prison?
Not only on the prison, but first on the street, because they dragged other men, so they were all chasing out and beating us, you see, with rifles and all kinds of sticks, fists, and chasing us through the center of the street, not on the sidewalks. On the sidewalks, you had Poles and Ukrainians clapping hands and saying, enjoying this spectacle. And this whole group was run into the prison. That's it.
And what did you find in the prison?
In the prison, we were chased into a corner and put to work to drag out bodies of prisoners who were executed by the NKVD. And what they did is they sealed them in cellars and set the prison on fire. There must be a few thousand bodies there.
When had they done this?
They were doing it probably from early spring. Sometimes they must have started it sometime, in my opinion, around March, April.
Who, the NKVD was setting it
yes.
on fire, not the...
No, they first executed the people and threw the bodies into the cellars and sealed the cellars.
Who were the people being executed, were they?
Well, that is a very difficult question because the criteria were Polish officers, policemen, owners of large shops, bankers, newspaper men, politicians, people in public eye engaged in some political activity, government officials. They had their criteria, and the criteria of the Soviet regime was very difficult to fathom.
Did anybody know that this was taking place? Was this new to you?
Not really. No.
You didn't know?
No. We heard shooting, but we didn't know what it is.
Were any people that you knew missing?
Oh, yes, there were very many members of the Jewish community, bankers, newspapermen, Zionists, politicians, anything. And my father was probably a candidate. They haven't bothered him because he was too influential and would cause too much of a commotion. But eventually that would be the case, too.
So you were put in there to remove the bodies?
We were brought there as Jews. And the Ukrainian nationalists were screaming and howling that we are the murderers, we are communists because we are Jews, we killed Christ, the usual. And we were given ropes and some people had to go down and the bodies were brought out. And I was working there. While I was working there, I've seen my father marched in with other Jews into a corner. But after the first group was brought in. From then on, they collected people in a corner of the huge yard and put two machine guns and executed them, among them my father, end of story.
Were you there?
Yes.
When your father was executed?
Yes, yes.
What was the name of that prison?
Brigitki.
Brigitki.
Yes.
It's rather well known.
It depends where. It was, at first it was probably a military sort of a campus or compound, and must have been also a prison, and they gave it a name of the saint, Santa Brigitta or something. In colloquial language, it's called Brigitki, yes.
This was all done by Ukrainians?
No.
Or by Germans as well?
Both.
By both?
Yes.
Did you see Germans?
Oh, yes. And there were two
SS
kinds.
SS or?
There are three kinds of Germans. One, you had their Germans belonging, or people in German uniform belonging to a Ukrainian battalion called Nachtigall. Nachtigall was a group of saboteurs and Fifth Column organized in Western Poland, occupied by the Germans, in preparation for attacking the Soviet Union. And they had German uniforms and blue and yellow ribbon patches. They were commanded by a future minister of refugees in the government of Konrad Adenauer, Dr. Theodor Oberländer. This was one group of the henchmen. The second one were German soldiers. They probably were also some SS people, also German police, Feldgendarmerie. So it's very hard to know, and besides, I was not inclined to make any inquiries because people were shot and quickly.
How long were you in?
All day long, from roughly 10 o'clock in the morning, and we were thrown out of there, the survivors, around probably 7 o'clock in the evening.
And where did you go?
Back home.
How far was this from your home?
Well, I would say probably distance of one city block.
What happened after that?
Well, I came back home. Obviously, I smelled of corpses. It's a very characteristic Swedish smell. So I washed up and I start. People were waiting at my house, my neighbors, because there were two of us who came out and we told them what happened. They wouldn't believe. And
the two, who was the second?
Myself and a son-in-law of my neighbor, a friend of my parents, were much older. He was a pharmacist, and he said to me, let's commit suicide, so we don't have to go there back tomorrow morning. And my mother talked me out of it.
Did you have to go back the next morning?
They told us to come back, but my mother said, you will not go, and I was hiding in the apartment on some library shelves.
Was this organized in the sense that they had your name?
Or No.
I'm going to change our tape again. interview with Mr. Kurt Lewin. How long did you hide in your apartment?
Until I was hiding in the apartment for a few days. But my suggestion is, this, needless to say, is a central event of my experiences under the Germans, which in a way has dictated a variety of things at a later date. I have written a book, Alitimi Spezia, which was published in Eretz Israel or Palestine in 1947 or 6 by Amuvet, describing in great detail this particular incident. I also have written an article which was published in the Ukrainian Annals, Academy of Science. And then recently I published a book, A Journey Through Illusions, published in the United States by Fithian Press. And I described this particular instance in great detail. Therefore, there's probably no need to dwell on it more.
That you remained hidden, however.
No, I was hiding while these people were running around loose in the streets, catching Jews. And once this subsided, I don't look particularly Jewish. One day I decided after 2 or 3 days that's enough. So I washed up, put on a suit, and went out. That's the end of it.
Your mother and your two brothers, once your father was killed, was
well, she wasn't aware of that.
Your mother was not aware.
No.
When did she become aware of that?
It was a lengthy process because, you see, my mother knew that my father went to Sheptytsky, to the Metropolitan. He offered him shelter. And there was a rumor circulated that he was hidden by the Metropolitan, which I knew is not true because I've seen him shot. But I didn't go out of my way to tell it to my mother. The next day after this incident, two SS men came. They had a list and asked for my father. So my mother said he was taken away. So they beat her up and left. This was part and parcel of the Nacht und Nebel operation, namely that a group of SS men was traveling to the occupied territories and taking prominent people according to the previously prepared lists and executing them. On this day, they executed Boy Zielinski, a prominent Polish writer, Bartel, former prime minister of Poland, prominent lawyers, Poles, leaders of the community, professors of university. They just were aiming at decapitating a society. My father was on this list, and therefore they came to pick him up, but he was already dead at that time.
When did your mother find out?
Oh, a few months later. She left the apartment, went to a district which was inhabited by non-Jews. We had friends there. The husband of this lady actually probably died in Brigitki because he was a banker. And we were staying there for 2-3 days until the situation quieted itself in the city.
Did you go with her?
Yes. No, she left and I joined her a few hours later.
So she left with the two younger children.
That's right. She was in a shock. She was beaten up, you know, after all. My mother was at that time 33 years old, without any means, hunger, and three children.
When you went out, as you said, you walked out, where did you go?
I joined my mother in this district inhabited by non-Jews.
How
on the other side of the city.
Uh-huh. And were you subject to any more?
No.
by the Germans at all? Or
no.
The Ukrainians?
No, because I don't look Jewish. Well, I didn't look Jewish at that time.
Did you have identification of any sort?
No, that was not necessary. I speak fluently Polish. I didn't speak Ukrainian, and I speak Polish without a trace of an accent.
During this time, how were rules and pogroms and stuff?
There were no rules.
There were none.
No, there were no rules.
How did you know what to do?
Well, I just kept my eyes open. Whenever I saw commotion, I tried to move the other way.
Were there restrictions?
Not yet.
Not yet. Was there a ghetto yet?
No. Everything was left alone.
How long was it left alone?
The restrictions came very gradually. The first thing they announced, the Jews are not allowed to use city parks. Then they have closed a district, which was the most luxurious one, and have actually evacuated everybody. And this was designed for the German civilian population, which came to occupy administrative positions in the city and for military. And then they have enlarged this district and told the Jews to get out.
Were there many Jews living in that luxury?
Oh, yes, because we intermingled. So the whole process, you see, of collecting Jews in a ghetto was very gradual. And Jews never knew what the ghetto is.
Where did the people who were evacuated from these luxurious houses go?
Well, they went to their friends. And eventually the Judenrat was assigning apartments and dwellings to these people, and that's it.
When your mother left, I know you said that she was in a state of shock, and you left afterwards. What did you take with you?
Nothing.
What happened to your possessions?
Nothing. The apartment was intact. They didn't rob anything. Didn't
did
take
you ever
anything.
Go back to that apartment?
Oh, yes. After we went back there, we lived there until Jews had to leave this particular district and move to a more restricted area, but it was much later.
So your first was not to go to parks, and then they were evacuating people. And what other, how else did the restrictions manifest?
You could be caught on the street and taken to forced labor, and either you came back or you didn't.
Were you ever caught on the
street? Oh, yes, many a time.
And what kind of forced labor did you
have? The railroad station.
What did you do at the railroad station?
We just dragged rails and all kinds of things. Sometimes, if we are lucky, we worked for German military units, and they made us work, but they didn't beat us up. And if we were unlucky, well, you were beaten, and that's the end of it.
If you were taken for labor, were you released in the evening, or was it just for a day?
Just for a day. Usually what happened is they had trucks standing on the street, and they were catching men, at that time only men, taking them where it was need to do some work, whatever the work is, either to remove rubble from bombing or to repair roads or to work at the railroad station, which was very heavily bombed, and things of that sort.
How often did you get caught to do this?
I was caught 3 or 4 times. And then I didn't like the idea, so I went out every morning at 4 o'clock, and I worked in outside of the city, far in the suburbs. This was under the Soviets. They had their a sort of a cooperative producing vegetables. And I used to go there because there it was quiet. And we were not beaten. We volunteered there. And as I liked agriculture and things of that sort, I enjoyed working there.
Is this at this point under the Germans or under?
No. There were locals.
Well,
yes. But the locals had free labor. We used to bring our own food, and that's it. So it was a reasonably decent way to spend the day and go home at night.
When was a Judenrat set up?
Immediately.
Who was in it?
Well, there were several Judenrats, and that is a complicated question. And I think, again, this was very carefully described and studied, so I rather not go into details of the Judenrat mechanism. Originally, these were leaders of the community, and they tried to protect the community. About 4 weeks after the Germans arrived, the general in charge of the city, infantry general, not NSS, imposed an enormous ransom on the Jewish community, and silver and all the precious things, jewelry, had to be brought to the Judenrat. Otherwise, reprisals were threatened. So this carpets, so people brought it simply to buy peace. And this was transported probably to Germany. This Judenrat was still an organized and sensible group of people, headed by Dr. Parnas, Josef Parnas. When they came to him and said, you have now to give us a few hundred people for labor camps, he refused. He said, money, yes. Cooperation, yes. Human beings, no. So they took him to a prison and shot him with the rest of the Judenrat. That's the end of the story. And then a new Judenrat showed up.
Who were the leaders? Who were picked to be Judenrat leaders?
There's no criteria.
I don't mean names necessarily.
I cannot answer that. I really couldn't.
Did you have any dealings with the Judenrat yourself?
And I was in the Parnas, Josef Parnas Judenrat. My mother got me there because while you were in the Judenrat, you had a little piece of paper, so you were left alone. And I was a clerk in the statistical department where they were preparing lists. This was, in my opinion, already set up to have better control of the Jewish population and set up the mechanism for its destruction eventually.
What kind of lists were they?
Names and addresses.
Anything more than names and addresses?
No. Address of a house on a street and who the Jews are who dwell there. End of story.
The second Judenrat, were they, or the one who followed Dr. Parnas?
I was not there because I was
there.
Taken with other clerks to the same prison, and I escaped from there. But it's, again, a long story. It's described in my book.
Where were you taken? Which prison?
The name of the prison was Lonskego. And whoever entered Lonskego rarely came out alive.
How were you captured to go there?
Well, they came with trucks, loaded us on trucks, brought us to the prison.
From where? Where did they find you?
At the Judenrat.
At the Judenrat.
Yes, there was several buildings because the whole administration had to be organized with Arbeitsamt, labor.
Where was it? Long?
Arbeitsamt means a labor department.
No, but the name of the prison?
Lonskego. It's a Polish name. Lonskego. It's an obscure name.
How long were you there?
About 2-3 days, and we were taken out to be shot.
Was this part of a Nazi?
No.
How did you get out of it?
I jumped out of the truck.
Alone? Anybody else jumped?
There were some others.
And were you hurt?
I was not. Some were hurt. Were shot.
Were shot?
Yeah.
Exactly where did you go to?
They took people to Piaski, which was a very notorious place of execution by the Germans at that time.
Piaski.
Piaski. Suburb, it was essentially a sand quarry.
And you didn't get to Piaski?
No, no.
You escaped before then?
That's right.
And where did you go to?
Home.
You went home?
That's right.
And home was your old apartment?
Yes.
Did they come looking for you?
No. Once you got out, you got out.
What happened after that?
After that, I was still hanging around the city for a while. And observing the situation, I came to a conclusion that I have to get out. And I went to Rabarovska.
And who was in Rabarovska? Your grandparents were still there?
No. Rabarovska was a strange city. It was a see of the local administration of the district, which means a court, schools, police under the Poles. And the Jewish community, primarily Jewish, maybe 80% of the population was Jewish. It was a service town. Its livelihood was strange because they were importing scraps of furs from Leipzig, which was a very important fur center. And it was fashionable in Central Europe and to some extent Western Europe for women to wear lamb's fur coat. So the scraps, as you cut the skins, were packed into huge sacks, were sent to this town, and there the Jews were sitting and sewing it together into units which were shipped back to Leipzig. That is the way they were eking out a living.
By the way, how far is Rabbi Ruska from?
About 50 miles.
What did you do in
I went there with a cousin of my mother, and we were there. We got ourselves a job as collectors of rags, scrap metal, and it was a subsidiary of Göring's Werke. Hermann Göring created an industrial empire for himself in Germany and Austria and Czechoslovakia. And in addition to that, there were subsidiaries. And one of these civilian Germans was running a subsidiary which was collecting rags, glass, scrap iron.
Where did you live there?
In Rava Ruska?
Yeah.
I lived in the office, which means there was a little office, and there I had my little corner, and at night I had two blankets, and that's it.
And the office was in the German?
In Rava Ruska, no, just in the city, center of the city. Tiny little office.
But were you under German domination?
Obviously, yes.
How were you being treated there, working?
Well, we worked there. There were no Germans in this whole unit. It was run by Jews and some Poles, so it was no problem. We were not paid anything. But we had what was called good papers, which allowed us not to be caught, what you refer to as Aktia, because it was vulgarly called as Nutzjude. Nutz in German means useful. You, the Jew, a useful Jew. And even there was an aluminum plaque to that effect.
Did you have identification?
Oh, yes, I have
a plaque of identification.
Yes, I
don't
have
any other outward, outside symbols.
Every Jew had to wear, under penalty of death, a armband with the Star of David.
And how many hours did you?
As much as I wanted to. It was not really the work we paid the German and the Poles for the papers, and we probably just were delivering symbolically some scraps here or elsewhere, which were collected by Jews whose livelihood this was before the war.
What about food and...
That's very hard to answer. You had to just simply, in a way, take care of yourself. The point is that while in Lwów there was continuous pressure, continuous violence, and presence of Germans and constant danger, in Rava Ruska they paid off the 5 or 6 German policemen, and the Ukrainian police was controlled by the Germans, who kept them in check. So there was no violence when I arrived there for a few months. Then the whole thing started there too, but at a much lower pace.
Did you have contact with your mother during this time?
All the time, because the post was functioning normally. And I got myself permits, which was rather unusual, to travel by railroad. So I used to go to Lwów every 2-3 months to visit my mother and my brothers.
And when you would go, you would wear all your...
Oh, yes, yes. It was very dangerous because I could be suddenly caught, and people say, take my documents away, tear them, and shoot me. So it was taking my life into my hands each and every time I went on the railroad.
Was there a ghetto in Rumoroska?
Yes, but it was not closed yet. Slowly was the same process, namely removal of Jews from the luxurious areas, then squeezing them into a smaller and smaller area, but the ghetto was not yet defined or closed.
You had mentioned that you were in the Lvov ghetto.
Yes.
Ghetto. When were you there?
Before my escape.
Before your escape?
Yes.
Did you have to move out of your house, or did the ghetto move into your house?
No. My mother moved first to one place and then to the final ghetto. Mm-hmm. She moved twice.
She moved twice?
Yes.
Did you move with her?
I was in Ravaruska.
So you never moved to a ghetto with your mother?
Mm-hmm.
But you visited her there?
Regularly. Stayed a few days, yes.
Where did she move to? Where did you visit her?
She lived, the first move was to what used to be a Jewish quarter. It was a Platz Theodora, actually, if you are interested. This was a square. They used to sell fish in a huge sort of a wooden tubs. This was not too far from the Orthodox synagogue.
Did she take the stuff from her house? Did you help her move?
Or No.
Did she do it on her own?
She has done it on her own, and she moved only few possessions, because the furniture, everything else was left behind. It was impossible to take. It was a limitation. The second move was into the final ghetto. I escaped shortly before it was closed.
So you lived in that second place?
For 2 weeks.
Did you help her move there?
No, I wasn't there.
How large was that, the second place, second ghetto?
The second place was one apartment shared by three families. So first she lived in an apartment by herself with the children. Then she shared an apartment with three more families. And then finally everybody had 3 square meters assigned.
And were you with her then?
Yes.
Who were the people that were around you that you were sharing
Well, I happened
to. Did you know them?
Oh, yes. In the first apartment, it was the widow of my uncle, who was shot with my father, also a prominent rabbi. His daughter, who was a child, and some other people whom I don't any longer remember. The final was the director of the gymnasium, which I attended, and his wife, and many other people I don't really recall.
How did people get along?
Very well. Much better than people here in New York. Despite all these extraordinary pressures. Furthermore, they were clean. They didn't run around in jeans and looked like refugees like people in New York. They, under the circumstances, still maintained human dignity.
Was there any social relationships? Did people get married? Did they
Yes.
in the ghetto?
Yes.
Did you attend any?
No, I didn't attend, but I'm aware. But why did people get married? A sister of my friend, a very beautiful girl, much older, slightly older than I, 2-3 years, married a Jewish policeman, because by marrying him, she was taken out of the Akcia, probably for 3 or 4 weeks.
And what about education? Were there any kind of programs for kids? Or
No. Forget about it. Not in Lviv.
What about death? When somebody died, what happened?
They buried
him. Talk about North. Where did they...
The cemetery.
Was the cemetery within the confines of the ghetto?
No. There were Jewish cemeteries.
Were there babies born?
Yes.
And do you remember any kind of ceremonies around that?
Not really. You see, you ask questions about expressions of normal community life. These were abnormal circumstances. And all I can tell you is, in order to put it in a proper perspective, try to imagine a pressure cooker was heat constantly increased, and people lived literally by the hour.
You mentioned the Jewish police.
Yes.
How did they behave?
That is a very complicated and a very delicate question. Why? In the Jewish police and its command, there were some very decent people who tried their best to help and alleviate their suffering. But don't forget that they were created as a mechanism to keep order in the community, keep it quiet and docile. Eventually, their job was to identify where Jews live and make it possible for the Germans to collect them in places where they were sent to the death camp. So, whether they were aware of it or not, very hard to say. The minority was quite beastly, robbed people. Others tried to help.
Your own experience with any Jewish people?
No, I had no experience because, you see, I moved my own way. There were also those who were vertrauensmen of the Gestapo. Men of who worked for the Gestapo, who were agents of the Gestapo.
Jews?
Oh, surely. And one of them, a prominent Jewish real estate operator here in New York, Bruce Teichholz, was one of them. What his role was, I don't know. But I know that he was one of the movers and shakers who, in the Jewish community, in the last Judenrats, which were essentially a mechanism to collect and destroy the community.
By the way, was there a wall around the ghetto?
Not in the beginning. Eventually, yes.
Were you there when the wall was erected?
I was there when the wall was erected, but I wasn't there when they closed because I didn't like to wait for that.
What kind of wall was it? What was it made of?
Well, they used usually the area, and for example, it was a railroad track which separated the ghetto from the rest of the city. And the rest was fenced in, wooden planks.
Wooden planks.
Yes, and wire.
Was there a guard?
Barbed wire. Pardon me?
Was there a guard at the...
Always.
Were there more than one entrance?
There were one or two entrances, simply because people used to march to work in the morning and come back in the evening.
And who were the guards, Jewish police or others?
Jewish police. Sometimes Ukrainian police. So when you speak about the Jewish police, you see, it's very hard to say that they were all collaborators and murderers and henchmen. Not necessarily. It's a very complicated subject.
I'm going to change our tape again.
Surely. Now.
Tape number four, interview with Mr. Kurt Lewin.
Well, you asked several times about life in the ghetto, either in Lwów or in Rawa-Ruska. probably to understand this, you have to accept the fact that there was no normalcy of any kind. Nothing was predictable or stable. Danger was looming at every moment in every corner. There was no protection of any law or any authority. A Jew was free, victim, and prey to everybody. So it was a life of a hunted animal, either hunted by the Germans or by the Ukrainian police or by local population. This is one aspect of this problem. The second aspect of the problem was a terrible hunger, starvation, because food was not available, or it was available and local population was selling food to Jews for gold or precious things, anything. Clothes, depriving these poor people of what was left to them. Third problem. By moving from place to place, they left their possessions behind because you couldn't carry it and the space was smaller and smaller. So try to imagine here to people who were constantly squeezed and under pressure. So your questions about celebrations, education and so forth don't apply.
Everybody, but they did happen. People did get married. People did have
they
children.
Got married because, you see, people in those days had a concept of correctness and dignity. And people wouldn't live together unless it was done in a traditional way by having a ceremony. End of story. Mm-hmm. But women got pregnant and gave birth. And people died, people were sick. The only circumstances, the circumstances were extraordinary.
Were you ever punished in the ghetto?
Punished by whom? For
Ukrainians,
what?
Ukrainians, Germans,
not really. There was some criminal police, Jewish criminal police, who dealt with criminals. But only to a certain point. I don't believe that there was anything of that sort.
Who were the criminals?
Jews are criminals too.
What kind of criminals were?
Well, thieves, pickpockets, murderers, anything you want.
Did these things take place in Ukraine?
Surely.
Were you witness to anything?
No.
Did people, I know you escaped from the ghetto. Was there much escape from the ghetto?
It was practically impossible to escape.
How did you escape?
Now, first of all, I've seen the horror of Brigitte, so I realized the full extent of the brutality, danger, and lawlessness. Secondly, as a child, I was usually more independent and more resourceful than the usual Jewish child, which was fearful and brought up to keep away from Gentiles. So this, you see, gave me a much greater initiative. And thirdly, I was privileged because people in the ghetto said, you are very fortunate because you don't look Jewish. You have an enormous asset. And I spoke the language. And that gave me maneuverability. Having escaped to Ravaruska, I could eat better because food was more accessible there.
But how did you escape?
From Lwów to Ravaruska. Very simply, I got myself with my wife's, my mother's cousin, this job in Apfelstoff Erfassung, and went there as a collector of rags. End of story.
So you had a legal exit from the...
Surely. And we arrived in Ravaruska, and we lived there. End of story. And from the documents, you'll find that this was organized in a certain way, and certain categories of people were left alone. After that, the pressure started to build up, and there were akcja, what you called. Akcja was essentially a organized collection of certain categories of people who were shipped to a death camp.
Were you in any akcja?
Oh, yes. Actually,
Where?
I was in Axtia, two in Ravaruska and two in Lvov.
Which came first, Ravaruska?
Ravaruska.
Tell me about Ravaruska. Were you in the ghetto there?
Yes and no. It was not a defined ghetto.
It had no walls or anything?
No.
How was the Nakatia in Ravaruska?
Ravaruska is about not more than 18 kilometers from Belzec. And the camp, the death camp in Belzec, it was not a concentration camp. It was just simply no more and no less gas chambers and crematoria. What people don't realize is that perhaps 1 to 1.5 million Jews were processed there. That was not far from Ravaruska, 18 kilometers. The Belzec death camp was erected, I think, in January, February 1942, shortly after the Wannsee conference. And the first group of Jews who were caught and taken to be tested as construction was completed were Jews from Ravaruska, 200 of them.
Did you know about it?
Oh, yes. We knew that they were killed there. We didn't know the method because the Ukrainians were not allowed to go there either. So they said that they killed Jews. How? There are all kinds of versions, by steam, by electricity, and so forth. But they knew that they are killed there.
So how was the selective done?
There was no selective.
How was the active?
They just simply came to town with trucks. Where the Feldgendarmerie, which is the military police, it's described in the book which was published in the United States, Regiment 101 of the Reserve Police. And they caught at random 200 people, put them on trucks, shipped them, and they disappeared. End of story.
We were talking about your being in a selectio or a Nazi.
Yes.
What do you remember about that? How was it done?
Well, Germans were running around catching Jews with the help of the Ukrainian police and with the help of local population.
Then what happened?
And they were collected usually next to the railroad station and shipped wherever they were shipped.
How did you get out of it?
Well, once in the second Akcja in Ravaruska, we were hiding in the warehouse where the rags were kept, in the rags. And I went to visit somebody, and a Ukrainian teenager grabbed me and started to drag me to the collection or to assembly area. As I told you, that I was a scrappy youngster, so I beat him up and ran away.
And from other Akcjis or
Selekcjis? In Lvov, the major Akcja, which probably was one of the largest, 60,000 people were collected. We were hiding in a cellar in the building where my mother lived for a while after leaving her original home. In this cellar, well, I ran out of there and went back to Ravaruska because of arrangements which I have described in my book. My mother was taken out of there because Polish women who were sitting there and selling vegetables pointed out to the Germans and to the Ukrainian police the Jews are there, and they were all taken to assembly point. My mother succeeded to pay off Jewish policemen with some jewelry she had, and she and my brothers were returned to the ghetto.
Did you have any other experiences in the ghetto before you left both Lvov and Ravaruska?
Hundreds of them, but I think they amount to the same.
What was your greatest fear there, other than being caught, obviously?
The fear was very simply to be caught and be brought to a situation which I found myself in Brigitki.
How did you manage to escape?
I kept my wits and I was alert. I watched around, watched what is happening around me, and lived like an animal, hunted animal, period, end.
What was the narrowest escape you had there?
Oh, there are not one, there are very many.
In your mind, what was the toughest situation you got out of?
One was to be shipped, to be shot in Lwów, to Piaski, without the members of the Judenrat. Two,
how did you get out of that?
I told you, I jumped out of a truck. Oh. Two, I was coming back from a visit in Ravaruska through side streets, and I ran into two SS men who were passing, it was Waffen SS, passing through Ravaruska, it was a railroad center. And they accosted me and asked me, what am I doing? Well, I said, I am a member of the Sanitätspolizei, which means Jewish police, health department. And I'm coming back from the hospital where I transported typhoid sick people. When they heard typhoid, they ran away. But this was a pretty close. I was lucky they didn't take a pistol. One of them didn't shoot me on the spot.
At what point did you leave Ravaruska?
It's very
go to Intiding.
First of all, the estate of my grandfather is about probably 12 kilometers from Belzec. Belzec had a sugar beet refinery, and I used to go there with shipments of sugar beet because it was interesting to observe it. Therefore, I knew the topography of the area, and I knew that Belzec is a dead end. Every day, I could see 10 or 20 trains coming from the direction of Lwów, going to Belzec and coming back empty. There was no space, you see, for these people to be collected there and shipped what they called resettlement. So it was quite clear that something is happening to them. That's what triggered in my mind the attempt to escape and looking for ways, which was very difficult. Some people forged documents, some were caught and shot. So it was rather frightening experience to get out of the ghetto, because this illusion that if you observe the law and the regulations you might survive, this was something which was fed to these people all the time by the Judenrats, by the Vertrauensmen like Bruce Teichmann or Teichholz, I don't remember. He was here in New York. I read an obituary of his death 2 or 3 years ago.
So where did you go?
First of all, I went to Lwów to consult with my mother. And then I told her that I would like to see the Metropolitan Szeptycki, at least safeguard the documents of my father, which she allowed me to do.
The Metropolitan, being the bishop?
The Archbishop, yes.
And how far was he from the ghetto?
What, probably 2 miles. In the city, though.
Did you go?
Oh, yes.
And what happened?
He received me very warmly, and I described it in my book, and asked me who I am, and was very moved when he learned that I am the son of my father, because he was aware that he was killed. And he said, documents, documents, but I think I would like to save you and others. He was aware of what's going on. And he asked me to come back after 3 or 4 days.
Did he outline any kind of plan for you?
No. When I came back after 3 days, he told me that he would like to take my brother, who was at that time probably 8 years old or 9 years old, and place him with monks and to discuss it with my mother and bring him to the palace. Well, my mother was not overly enthusiastic, But eventually she realized, because this was after the major actions, that sooner or later it will end badly. She was already on her way to Belzec. So she agreed. So did my brother. So the next time we took him there.
We being you?
Myself, my mother, and my younger brother, who's 9 years old. And we were received in the office of the Metropolitan, the Archbishop. There was a priest waiting. He promised my mother that he would take care of him, be his guardian. And the priest took my brother, Father Kyprian, and that's the end of it. And I returned with my mother alone to the ghetto.
Did you have contact with Father Kyprian and your brother?
Oh, yes, later on.
Later on, but how long did you not have contact with him?
Until I went to visit my brother in the monastery where he lived. I went there. It's a place called Pidmihailiuchi, which is about, again, 70 miles from Lviv.
And when did you yourself?
Well, I came back and my mother told me, look, this boy is 9 years old and he cannot manage by himself. You have to go. And so I agreed to it, and I spoke to again to the Metropolitan, who said, fine. And I understood that if I get out, my mother will be eventually rescued, but she refused. And so I went away. That was sometime October 1942, about maybe a month and a half before the ghetto was closed.
How did you go away? How did you disappear?
Very simple. I just walked to the palace with a little valise, few of my belongings, and I came out of there without the Jewish armband, and I was taken to an orphanage where I was placed for a few days and then taken to another monastery, and that's it.
Who knew you were Jewish?
All the monks knew that I'm Jewish.
Did they know your brother was Jewish too?
Probably.
Were there other Jewish children there?
Later on I found out, yes, quite a number.
What was it like? What kind of, I mean, you weren't a little kid anymore.
No.
So you were taken into an orphanage, and how old were the orphans?
They're teenagers, 12 to 16.
What were you expected to do?
Nothing. But this was a temporary place until, you see, to place a Jew was not so easy in those days. A reason being is, sorry to be vulgar, but in Europe, Jews, only Jews are circumcised. Gentiles are not, and therefore they didn't bother with any documents. Consequently, to place a Jew was not an easy business.
There were only young boys that were taken.
Yes. Nuns took girls. I found girls eventually too, but that's much later. The people didn't advertise it because for the penalty for saving a Jew or keeping a Jew was death. Therefore, the whole thing was done very discreetly.
Now, who were your contacts in this orphanage? How long were you in the orphanage?
About 2-3 days.
And then where did they send you?
They sent me to next door, about maybe a kilometer from there, was a man's monastery, the John the Baptist monastery. There I was kept for a month.
And what were you? Were you using your own name?
No. I was already given this false name, Roman Mitko, and I was kept locked up in the cell. My only contact was with a priest, monk priest, who was teaching me language. I didn't speak Ukrainian. Custom, culture, how to pray, and things of that sort. So I was, in a way, quickly trained to be adapted to my surrounding.
Did you have contact with anybody other than that monk who was teaching you?
Well, I used to go to the refectory to have meals with the monks. I could wander around the monastery.
And they all knew you were Jewish?
In the beginning, maybe not, because they thought that maybe I'm a novice. Then slowly and gradually, it became clear to them.
Did you keep your own clothing, or did they give you monks' clothing?
At that time, I had my own clothing.
What about food?
No, the food I ate, the food of the monastery.
There was not an issue?
Of what?
Of the fact that their food may not have been kosher? Or anything.
Well, this
for
you see...
For you?
No, may I tell you something? I realize the morbid obsession with gastronomic rules which the nowadays Jewish theologian has. But under the circumstances, the question was not, you see, to have kosher food, but to have food to survive the day, first of all. And secondly, the monks did not worry about providing me with kosher food.
Was there an attempt to convert you?
No.
Was there an attempt to have you be involved in your own religion as well, or to retain?
You couldn't, because, you see, I was observed all the time. The minute I would start, you see, any religious practices, I would endanger the whole community and myself.
How long did you think of, what did you think of yourself? Who were you there?
Myself. Yeah.
Did you think of yourself as Kurt Lewin, or did you think of yourself as, what was your false name?
My false name was Roman Mitka.
And did you think of yourself as Roman Mitka?
Not really. I knew that this is my name, and the same way as my brother knew that he had his name, was different from mine, in order not to make any connection in case either of us is caught.
Were you in the same monastery?
No.
Did you ever fear that you would be giving yourself away?
I was in constant fear. Constant fear. So were they. They were afraid that if I'm caught, they will be shot.
How did you learn to be Ukrainian?
How does one learn to be a Ukrainian? Very simple. You see, as long as you realize that your life depends on it, you learn very quickly.
What about mannerisms?
Well, that I was taught, and I'm a very quick learner. So I had to learn, first of all, mannerisms. I had to learn very quickly the language and the ways of Ukrainian prayers and behave in the church. I never went to the sacraments, but I had to make the right moves and the rhythm of what was going on.
Why didn't you go to the sacraments?
I'm not a Catholic, and I didn't want to respect. They told me not to go to sacraments because of blasphemy. Because they believe that the host is the body and of Christ.
Did you ever think of becoming a Catholic?
Not really. That was not in my mind at that time, because the question was the survival from day to day, from hour to hour.
How many people were in that in the monastery?
I was in a variety of monasteries.
No, but the first one.
The first one, I would say probably close to 30.
And how long did it take you to get used to all the ways of living as a monk or a novice?
Probably 2 months or 3 months. After 3 months, I was sufficiently trained that I could sing in a choir with them, learned Old Slavonic, because they pray in Old Slavonic, and participate in all the ceremonies without any problem.
How did they treat you? Were they nice to you?
They treated me the same way as they treat me today. In their minds, I am one of them, and they treated me as a friend, as part of the community.
You were 17, 16, 17 years old?
17, 18.
Was there, it's a different kind of feeling, I would imagine, when you're 17 and 18 than now. Did you suspect any kind of treatment that was different towards you than towards other novices?
No. I was treated the same way as everybody else. I worked with them as everybody else, which was not easy. It was a very hard life, very difficult. We faced the danger the same way. And all I can say, curiously enough, I said in all conscience today from perspective of 71 years of life and other experience, these were the happiest days of my life. Why? I lived with people who were decent, who tried to live by the Gospels. I didn't say that they were perfect, who provided me with shelter and never made me feel that I'm an outsider, who accepted the same risk of being caught and shot which faced me by simple fact that I'm there. And while there was a storm all around me, I was, in a way, like in a Noah's Ark.
Were you aware that there were other Jews there?
In the beginning, no.
When did you find out?
Slowly and gradually, because this was a silent order, and we communicated only half an hour a day in the so-called recreation. And then gradually, they let me know indirectly.
How?
When
you say they, you mean other Jews?
No.
Or monks.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, just hinted that one saw my brother somewhere and is well. Another mentioned that the Jew is sitting in the cellar. A third one told me that this German priest, Father Peters, keeps four Jewish families in the cellar of the factory which he ran, and so forth. And all this was. And one day I met a monk. He was Brother Daniel, with a beard. And I asked him, he didn't know that I'm Jewish, because I already looked, he was not in the same monastery as I was. I so asked him, Father Daniel, what are you doing? Well, he says, I'm running a cheder. He ran an orphanage. And in this orphanage, there were three Ukrainian children and 17 Jewish children, boys.
And he used the word cheder?
Absolutely.
Did he assume that you would know what it meant?
Well, every Ukrainian knows what the cheder is. They lived together, you see, for centuries.
Was there any homosexuality in the monastery?
No, I have never encountered any homosexuality. None. It's only a figment of imagination of the sick Western mind, especially American mind. I lived in a monastery for 2 years at very close quarters. I'm sorry to disappoint you. I wasn't molested, and I haven't seen anything, which I'm pretty keen observer, as you can gather.
Were there any narrow escapes were?
Oh, yes. Many.
We're going to leave them for the next day.
What? For next day? Sure then.
With Mr. Kurt Lewin. Where did most of those monks come from? What was their economic or social background? Education?
Very briefly, the Ukrainian community is primarily consisting of peasants. There are several monastic orders, like the Basilians, Redemptorists, and so forth. But these orders accepted only educated Ukrainians. The Metropolitan Shchetinsky decided to create a framework for sons of peasants without education. And this was the order, which was created at the turn of the century and dedicated itself to reviving Eastern monasticism. Without going into too many details, the composition of the monk's body was primarily people of the land. Some were educated, some were illiterate. Some had skills, some had to be taught skills. There were some who were quite well educated. There was an art expert and painter of icons. There was a man who was married, and he was an accountant in the town. He, in an epidemic, his wife and children died, so he joined the monastery, but a highly educated man. Marek was a former banker. So it was a mixture. Yes.
The Ukrainians, as you had indicated earlier, were fairly anti-Semitic.
Yes.
What about these monks? Were they from the same background?
The same background.
And were they in any way anti-Semitic?
Some were.
How did it manifest itself in the
They didn't history? Like Jews.
But did they know you were
yes.
you were Jewish?
Yes.
Were you ever betrayed, or did you think you were ever betrayed?
No. No. You see, the fact that they liked or disliked Jews had nothing to do with what they have done. They resented the fact the Jews were being killed. They resented the bestiality. And they tried to help. Because they felt that within their limited circumstances, they couldn't, in their conscience, to sit quiet on the sidelines. Some objected to having Jews in the monastery, quite openly.
And how did they simply said so?
Said so.
And
because they said that the community is being endangered. But they never betrayed a Jew, never, you see, interfered with it. But they are entitled to their views.
Were there communications, radios or newspapers, contacts with the outside world?
Very little.
Where did the news come from?
Well, first of all, there was a Ukrainian paper which was controlled by the Nazis and by Ukrainian nationalists, pro-Nazi nationalists, which provided the usual information issued by the Ministry of Propaganda. In the library in the city, there were German newspapers, but it was dangerous for me to show that I speak German. So I kept away from it. Radio was the same. There was some local radio, but most of the news came through hearsay and visitors.
How much contact did you have with your brother? How often did you get to see him or hear about him?
It was arranged for me to go and see him after I adapted to the environment. And a mother superior of the Basilian nuns took me by train at night, which was very dangerous because she endangered her own life. Her name was Monika Polańska. Monika Polańska was a physician. She was born in Philadelphia, a Ukrainian. And she was widowed, and she sold her property and went back and became a nun and a superior of this particular house in Pidmihailivci was the name. So she took me there, transported me with her, And the chaplain of this monastery, Father Kiprian, kept my brother, because he also was being trained to be a Ukrainian, as you said. In order to put my mind at ease, I was there for a week. And then when Mother Monica Polanska had to see a lawyer in a nearby town, she took me there, and we traveled by sleigh in the winter. And from there, I went to another monastery. Then I didn't see my brother for a year until I came back to Lviv. And then he was brought to Lviv too, as the Germans were approaching.
Into another monastery?
He took care of pigs.
Your brother took care of pigs?
Yes.
As a monk?
No.
As a Jew?
No, certainly not. As a boy, as an orphan.
And you?
I was in the monastery, working in the archives as a monk.
In Lviv.
And the monks who ran the household and the stables were living in the same monastery where I did. And my brother used to go and eat there, so I have seen him daily, but we never had any contact unless under special circumstances.
In other words, you could not recognize each other.
We recognized, but we tried not to acknowledge each other, because we both understood that it is better that people don't know that we are brothers. But he used to come and visit me in my cell. Cell is the room where I lived.
The time that you were in three monasteries, and the time that you were in these three...
Four.
In that time, did you have any knowledge about what was happening to your mother?
Yes, indirectly. I knew that she's left in the ghetto, and while I was in the first one, I went with Father Marek to visit her, which was taking our lives in our hands, and I went to see her. And I told her that she should make an effort to get out. She told me, I'm a widow. My husband is dead.
She knew it that
way. Oh, surely. My youngest son is not normal under the circumstances. He will not be able to survive. I cannot leave him. So here I am. And besides, I'm not so sure that with all my world gone, because it was quite evident at that time that I wish to survive. Subsequently, my impression is some efforts were made to get her out. It's not possible from the ghetto. But Father Marek once brought me a little note from her, written to me. I'm still alive. I translate. Leon is no longer with us. Forget us and enjoy life. Signed, Hella, end of story. That was the last communication.
Were you aware that the war was coming to an end? How were you aware?
Slowly. You see, first of all, Stalingrad. Don't forget that the Ukrainians are communicating among themselves and the priests and so forth. It was quite clear that trains full of wounded and frozen people are coming back from Russia.
Germans.
Secondly, there was a partisan activity. The Ukrainians created a partisan force which fought the Germans, because the Germans were beastly toward the Ukrainians too, in a different way. And thirdly, we learned about Stalingrad probably 2 or 3 months after it happened. Finally, a partisan division, Kopak, marched through the back of the German front from Belorussia all the way into Hungary and passed near us where I was in the mountains.
Kopak stood for
Kopak. That is the name of the general.
Oh, General Kopak?
Yes.
And that was a partisan group?
No, it was a semi-regular group. It was a division which crossed through the forest the German line and marched all the way from Belorussia, cutting supply lines of the Germans during the major battles. It's quite notorious.
Were they Ukrainian?
No, there was a Red Army.
Red Army.
But some Ukrainians joined. There were some Jews who joined.
And that's how you found out about Stalin.
We knew that something is happening.
When did you find, when were you liberated?
Also, we knew that the Germans, the German is heavily bombed.
How did you know that?
Or hearsay, Peters was a German.
When and how were you liberated?
Hmm?
When were you liberated?
Well, as the front started to approach, as Ehumen Clement, the brother of the Metropolitan, who was in charge of all that, realized that things are changing, he started to collect the Jews in Lwów.
In where?
In Lwów, in the main city. So my brother was brought from a village where he was to Lwów and started to take care of pigs in the residence. It was a huge compound. I was brought back to Lwów, and some other children and some other Jews I discovered were brought to Lwów.
Did you have a choice?
No.
You were just sent?
You were told, you are going here, going there, the same way as a monk. Now, then the Germans, the Russians started to bomb the city, night after night. Subsequently, you could hear the artillery battles. And then there was quiet for 2-3 months, but you saw the Germans running out in a less orderly fashion. One day, carrying books to the residence of the Metropolitan, I stumbled on a Russian sniper, a woman, lying there, and was I realized that the Russians are in the city.
Was there a formal liberation for you?
What does it mean, formal?
Somebody came in to tell you that you were free?
No. Not only that, but I kept still my Ukrainian identity. I didn't want to say anything. I still acted and waited for 3-4 weeks until you see the situation stabilized. The Germans could have come back.
When you realized that the Russians were in the city, was the monastery at risk?
I'm sorry?
Was the monastery at risk? Was the order at risk under the Russians?
No,
the Soviets?
Not at that time.
When did you actually leave
the I discussed it with Clement, who was a very wise man, and he pointed out to me that if I stay in Lwów, I will be mobilized to the Russian army. And as Poland is liberated and there is a Polish Committee of National Liberation in Lublin, it would be prudent to move there and contact world Jewry, because he had the same misconceptions I had, that Jews will take care of these survivors and they will be, in a way, provided with assistance and so forth, which was not the case. Anyway, after about 2 months, I decided to move on. And I crossed the border, or demarcation line is better, between the newly created Poland and Russia, because the territory where I was formally annexed to the Soviet Union.
Where did you cross to?
In Ravarovsk. Because yes,
that was the line of demarcation?
This was the border line is after Ravaruska, still
and
today.
So you went to?
First to Ravaruska.
And then to? Lublin.
And then I crossed with the assistance of the local Greek Catholic priests.
Were you in habit?
Until Ravaruska? Yes. From Ravaruska, no.
What kind of habit was it?
It's a sort of a black cassock with a leather belt, which a novice wears.
And did you have your any other clothing?
I had normal clothing, yeah, because this was used only during services in church, but not during
work.
And
what did you wear otherwise, just ordinary?
Normal clothes, pants, shirt. I had a little length wool sort of a... I looked like dressed like a peasant.
And when you left, what date was that?
I assume that it must have been September 1900, first week of September 1944. The Soviets liberated the city in June 1944. I stayed through July and most of August in the city, in the monastery.
In the monastery. What was the leave taking like? How did you leave the monastery, your metropolitan and the Clement?
Well, the decision for me to leave was made by the Clement, the brother of the metropolitan. The metropolitan was very ill. He died 3 months later. Secondly, Clement told me, before you leave Poland, finish your education, because otherwise you cannot go to a university. Remember that you have to finish your university studies. And if you get out after the war, go to Rome and report what you have seen. And when I have provided him with the decision that I intend to go, so in the monastery it was arranged, first of all, to provide me with shirts. Those days it was a major effort to make sure that I have a decent pair of shoes, socks, clothing. They looked into their chest to find some money and gave me what they had. Gave me a bottle of wine, some bread. And the night before I left, the monks used to, after services, came to my cell one by one, saying goodbye, and everybody brought a little gift, whatever they had. It means a little picture. The holy pictures which they have, a prayer book, a pair of socks, a handkerchief. It was like a family sending a member of the family away. Then I was asked to come to the residence of the Metropolitan. It was on his deathbed. And I was brought there, and he greeted me and blessed me, and the same his brother. The next morning, I went on the road, caught a Soviet truck, and they transported me to Rabarovska. End of story.
When did you take your habit off?
In Rabarovska.
Do you have any specific memories of that day of leaving, personal memories?
Of the monastery?
Of leaving these people that you'd spent 2 years with?
More or less the same when I left my mother. Because I dealt with people, I lived with people who have taken extraordinary risks, provided me with not only shelter, but with an environment where the terrific emotional shocks and wounds could heal somewhat. And therefore, I felt sorry to leave them, but I realized it's not my environment and I have to. You asked about incidents, close shaves. Well, I was walking in Lwów maybe 8 months before the Germans left with a monk by the name Varlaam. If you listen, it's an old Slavonic name. Varlaam sounds like Abraham. And this monk had round, sad Jewish eyes. He was bald and was a beard. He was a Ukrainian. We were stopped by a German patrol and Ukrainian patrol. And they turned to me and said, Reverend, brother, we think that your colleague is a Jew. They took him into a doorway to take his pants off. I was standing there. I didn't get gray, but the 5 or 10 minutes before they came out apologizing was a rather unusual experience. I had many shaves like that, but it's too long and it would take too many tapes, and I think it's repetitious.
What is your best feeling and memory of your 2 years in the monastery? How would you evaluate?
Best moment. I used to get depressed from time to time, but I didn't have yet the benefit of a psychobabble and mental health clinics. So I can only see that today. And there's a monk, he's still in Canada, Brother Lawrence. He was an apiarist. So he used to go to the superior and say, I think that Roman has to help me today in the apiary because he wants to extract honey. When I used to come there, I used to cut, you see, a honeycomb of the beehive and give it to me, and so I could enjoy some honey, which did a great deal for my soul, and my depression was dissipated.
What were your worst? What were your worst experiences in the monastery time?
When I went to the mother house, and they didn't know that I'm Jewish, and they assumed that I'm a novice. So they exposed me to the training of a novice, and I had to sit on my knees for 2-3 hours and listen to singing, which was totally alien, and participate in all kinds of things. I thought I would go mad until I started to adapt to it. Second point, I was perpetually hungry, because food was brought and served. There was a huge table in the refectory. It was roughly 80 monks. And first the abbot used to get, was served, and then down the road. But the novices were at the end. So usually the abbot used to knock, it's time to go back to prayers and to work. So when food came to the novices, we had no time to eat. It's part and parcel of the training.
When you crossed into Poland,
yes.
Who were you? Were you Kurt Lewin or were you Roman Nitka?
Across the border, actually, singing in the funeral of a peasant, because you couldn't cross the border demarcation line easily. So a peasant died in a village, but the cemetery was in Soviet Union, but he lived in Poland. So I went with the priest from Radaruska to participate in the funeral, and I sang as a cantor, which I'm trained, by the way, with the funeral, but I returned with the priest from the Polish end, and that's the way I crossed the border, and from then on I tried to become myself again.
Which name did you use?
Kurt Lewin.
In Poland?
Yes, for only 3 weeks. Then I realized that there are pogroms, Jews are being killed. And although the Germans are gone, the Poles are still creating a danger. So I shifted to a Polish name, and that's it.
And what did you become then?
Roman Matkowski.
Did you have papers in that name as Matkowski?
I fabricated them.
You yourself fabricated
yes.
them. When you were Roman Matkowski or Roman Mitka, were you thinking as Roman Matkowski, or were you thinking as Kurt Lewin?
I had to think like Roman Mitka. Otherwise I wouldn't survive, or I would go mad. Equally so, I served in the Polish army as a Roman Matkowski. So I had to think like Roman Matkowski. I had to suppress and just put things in a little corner.
What was your job in the army, the Polish army?
I was an infantryman. I was a second lieutenant because I knew how to read and write. And then after the war, for a short while, I was sort of a head of a office, you know, clerk, senior clerk. But you see, the question which you ask is the same which faces me today. In order to communicate with my present environment, I cannot revert either to my life as a monk, or my life in the ghetto, or life in the Polish army, or for that matter, life in Israel. So this is a corner, you see, which...
Who were your friends in Poland when you were in the army?
Quite a number of people, because I make friends very easily. And some survivors.
Did the people in the Polish army know, anybody know you were Jewish?
No.
How long were you in the army?
From September or October 1944 until May, June, until August 1945.
Did you leave on your own or were you dismissed?
No, I demobilized because, you see, having served during the war in combat, I was entitled to be demobilized immediately when the war ended or shortly afterwards.
And what did you do then?
I picked up two Catholic priests, Father Marek and another one, and we ran away from Poland to Germany.
Did you, in the course of this time, did you go to school in Poland?
No.
Like the priest
no.
asked you to do, the monk asked
no,
you to do?
No, but I was stationed near Warsaw, and there was a gymnasium, and I went to this fine lady who was the director of the gymnasium, told her that I am a Pole from Lwów and I couldn't finish my schooling and I would like to get a degree in how to go about it. Well, she said, you can sit down to an examination as an external student. We will test you and see whether you can do it. So I was there for almost 2 months. And the teachers were very kind because they worked with me on a variety of subjects, prepared me for the examination, and I sat down and I passed it, and I have a certificate, which is a baccalaureate.
And your certificate is as Roman
yes.
Matkowski.
Yes, Roman Matkowski.
Matkowski.
Yes.
In being back in Poland and witnessing anti-Semitism, were you witnessing it? Were you subject to some of this as a Jew? Or
no, I just watched it.
You just watched
no,
it?
No, I wasn't. I didn't function in Poland as a Jew.
How did you get out of Poland?
I smuggled these two priests out of Poland illegally to Czechoslovakia and from there to Germany.
Three of you?
Yes,
smuggled.
We traveled. I described it in the book.
And were there risk factors in that?
Yes, certainly, because he could be caught by the Russians. And once we crossed the Russian demarcation line, there was no risk anymore.
Who helped smuggle you?
I would assume today, looking, I didn't know precisely, but I think that there must have been some underground organization guided by the Haganah people in Europe, which was called Brecha, and they organized the transports of Jews, men, women, and children, westward, from Poland to Germany.
How did you handle the priests with the Brecha?
I forged Jewish papers for them.
When you left, when did you become Kurt Lewin again?
I became Kurt Lewin the minute I left Polish border.
And how could you do that legally?
There was no need to
how
do it.
How did you prove that you were Kurt?
That's a complicated question. I had on several occasions some problems to prove my identity.
Going west, what were your goals? Where were you heading to?
First, get out of Poland. Because I understood being among the Poles and living among these people as a Pole, there's no place for a Jew there. So my choice was either to submerge and remain as a Pole, which I could easily, because I could also make a career if I wanted to, because of reasons which again I described in my book, so I don't want to belabor this. But I had no interest in it. So I tried to move westward. And having been exposed to the Holocaust and variety of other things, I intended to go what was Eretz Israel and Palestine and start life there, especially that I came out of an environment which was Zionist.
When you did become Kurt Lewin again, and you were in a Jewish environment, Did you assume any of the ritual practices that you had had in your home?
Yes, I returned to be an Orthodox Jew. I joined a group of Orthodox Jews in Italy and traveled with them to Palestine. And while I was at the Hebrew University, I was a practicing Orthodox Jew, yes.
How long did it take for you to sort of swing back into being Jewish again?
Not at all. Immediately. No problem.
What connection, or did you have any connection with the agencies that were helping Jews in DP camps at all?
Very few and mostly unsatisfactory.
Why?
I arrived in Rome and went to join AJDC, American Jewish Distribution Committee, headed by, at that time, a very good-looking lady whom I know socially here. She's in New York. I said, here, I came from Poland, and I don't know anybody. Would you guide me? So she started to yell at me and told me, get out. Now it's lunchtime.
But I think our timing is just about the way
how much, how many tapes do you want still?
It's not what we want. It's what you still heard, Lewin. Did you spend much time in DP camps?
No.
Did you? Who were your friends? Who were the people you hung out with?
Well, people whom I traveled from Poland to Germany. We traveled 3 weeks. It's a long journey, complicated journey, and I befriended some of the peoples and maintained contact with them for a while. Then life separated us. In Rome, I lived in what they refer to as a kibbutz. This was a group of Orthodox people who led a communal life. There were about 100 of us, 120, living in a villa near Rome in Lido di Roma.
And what was the goal of this kibbutz?
The goal of the kibbutz was to proceed to Palestine, but it was illegal, so they were waiting for the illegal immigration.
And did you?
Ali Abdate.
Did you get to Palestine?
Yes.
How?
It's described in my book. This is the same ship which Leon Uris turned into a story, the Exodus. It was a hunger strike in the harbor of La Spezia. And after the hunger strike and all kinds of other events, we were eventually given certificates which were issued by the British, and we went to Palestine.
And how were you received in Palestine by the issue?
Well, I look at it from a distance of time and objectively. I think the issue was very small. There were about 7,000 Jews at that time. Secondly, its resources were relatively limited, and they tried their utmost to receive us as well as they could.
What year are you talking about?
It was May, to be precise, 1946.
So who became your friends in Palestine?
I found some members of my family in Tel Aviv. I had many friends among those with whom I traveled or lived in Italy. And then I made new friends in Israel at the university where I studied, and then eventually in the Haganah.
Who helped you to get into the university? Were there any agencies or organizations?
No. First of all, I have documentation that I am a graduate of not high school, but it is an equivalent of 2 years college. So I qualified for admission as a matriculated student. Secondly, a member of the Jewish agency at that time, Emil Shmorak from Lviv, was a friend of my father, and he was kind enough to take interest in me and introduced me to the registrar of the Hebrew University, Dr. Poznański. So I was admitted without any difficulty because of my documents. But what's more important, I was given free tuition. And Dr. Shmorak arranged a small stipend for me of 20 Israeli or Palestinian pounds a month, which allowed me to subsist in Jerusalem and study.
Was that usual for people who came to
Not really. You have to have very powerful connections for that. Then I published my book, and I suddenly became a man of means, because I got 200 Palestinian pounds for my book. So I was much more relaxed.
Bob, your life in Palestine, and then what subsequently became Israel, was rather difficult. It was a military life.
Difficult? No. First of all, I was there at a very interesting time, and I was privileged to be still in the days when the old Zionist idealism permeated the country. I lived in the kibbutz for a while, and then at the Hebrew University. I was very happy and very proud to be part of it. I was a member of the Haganah, and then I graduated from the Haganah Commander School, illegal commander school, which was a privilege, was perhaps physically very hard, and maybe also emotionally hard, because I had to adapt to Sabras and people with a different outlook from mine, who didn't have the horrible burden of the memories of the Holocaust. But by and large, if I did not insist on bringing up the Holocaust or show a deep sense of sorrow for myself, I was accepted and functioned among them reasonably well and was quite happy. Then I was part of the creation of the State of Israel, so these were historical days. It was a privilege.
Were there many people who had had your experience of being survivors in the Haganah?
Yes, but not on the level in which I was. No. None.
When did you reconnect with your brother?
Well, I was in touch with my brother after the war all the time. However, I left him in Poland with the understanding that I would get him out. But I got trapped in difficulties of living as a displaced person in first Germany, then Italy, then in the La Spezia affair. And my conditions in Israel were such that it was not really possible to bring him over. And besides, I couldn't get a permit for him. Then the war broke out, so I met him again 1951 in December on my way to the United States.
And where was he?
In London.
In London. He managed to get out on his own.
He was sent with a group of children to London in 1900, I believe, 45, sometime in the autumn, probably September, October.
After your experiences with the Haganah and the Wars of Liberation in Israel, you came to the United States.
Yes.
What did you do here?
Well, I was here twice. I was here once on a mission of the Israeli government to be sent to finish my graduate studies at Columbia. And I was attached to the United Nations mission for a year and a half. I married my wife here, and we went back to Israel. I carried on my career until she became very ill.
Your wife's name
again? Olga Gruss Lewin. Eventually, she died, unfortunately, in 1963. But again, a variety of experiences and raised some questions in my mind, and I just did not wish to lead people, and I didn't want to be a politician. So I had no choice, because my record is such that I couldn't just step aside, and I didn't wish to continue either a government career or military career or a political career, and I didn't want to go back to academia, so I had no choice.
You went into
economics to make a living, and I started as a messenger boy on Wall Street.
Your children were born in the United States.
Yes.
How much of their story, your story, do they know, other than perhaps reading your book? But
well, I, as you can see, have no sensitivity on the subject, and therefore I communicated with a variety of people on what has happened, and survivors, other survivors visited me, so my children are fully aware of my background. Besides, I became involved in the process of beatification of this Archbishop Metropolitan.
How did you do that?
I was called to testify as a witness, because I'm one of the few people who lived with him and worked in his archives.
Where were you called?
I was called to testify in a process of beatification in Rome.
Could you tell us what that involved?
What it involved is that my testimony was concentrated on two things. One, on the behavior of this Archbishop Metropolitan during the Holocaust, the fact that he came out with an open pastoral letter condemning the killing of Jews and warning his flock not to participate directly or indirectly in this horror. And the pastoral letter's title is You Shall Not Kill. This is one point. Secondly, he also organized in the monastic orders and in his diocese a formal action of saving Jews. And to my amazement, with time it became apparent to me that there were more than 200 people saved. It's recorded. There's a file on the subject in Yad Vashem. Clement was recognized as righteous by Yad Vashem, so was Steck, Father Steck, and the Studites. They have some questions about the Metropolitan because of controversies which were injected by Poles, by KGB, and so forth.
Was he ever beatified?
No, he wasn't beatified. That is a lengthy process.
So that there is, it's still in...
It's still ongoing, yes.
Ongoing.
The formal first phase of the process is finished, and I helped the postulation, as it is called, in collecting documents and doing research, because they quickly became aware that I can testify not only to the activities connected with saving and sheltering Jews, but I'm also able to assist in unraveling the complex political and economic and social situation in this part of the world during the lifetime of this individual.
Did your children meet these people at all?
Oh, yes.
Did they ask you questions, or was it just something that part of your
life? It's part of my life, because you see the picture of the Metropolitan and his brother is in my bedroom. These are people, my benefactors, thanks to whom I live. Father Marek, as long as he was alive, used to come and visit me and visit my children. Many other monks came and went. The older boys are named Andrew and Clement to commemorate the fact that these two extraordinary human beings saved not only my life, but befriended Jews at the time when nobody was interested to befriend Jews and had compassion. Very rare phenomenon in this part of the world at that time.
Did your experiences have any impact on how you raised your two sons? And I know you have a third son.
Yes. I have made clear that I am brought up as a Jew. I am a Jew and I think like a Jew. Whether this is a particular advantage, my answer is no. Why and how, it's a long discussion, not related here, but I always could dissolve in the Christian world at choice, because among Ukrainians, up to this day, I'm not recognized as a non-Ukrainian. The same applies to the Poles. So the moment of truth came when my firstborn was born, and I asked myself whether I should let him be circumcised, which was a curse. I have to remind you of my walk in Lemberg, who's the poor brother Varlaam, who was taken to a door of a building to have his natural documents checked. But once I decided to circumcise my oldest son, well, using a Latin expression, alla iacta est, I cast my dice. If I were confronted with the decision today, I'm not sure I would do that.
In terms of education or identification, are they involved in any Holocaust
no.
movements at all? And
no.
And education-wise?
They know about the Holocaust. Involvement in Holocaust is, I think, a debatable activity, because one shouldn't dwell in this tragedy. One should remember, one should respect it.
What about other Jewish institutions? Are they involved in any?
My older boys are raised as Orthodox Jews. They went to Sunday school and had their bar mitzvahs, and organized by my non-Jewish wife, who's an expert on the subject. And my older son goes to a synagogue and raises his children in a traditional Jewish way. My younger son is halfway, and it's neutral.
Your grandchildren, are they aware of your experiences?
Well, they're too small. How can one be aware of these experiences?
When they're, well, can you answer that?
I don't think you can.
Does one make your children
no,
aware?
You cannot.
Or does some people
no,
don't want to make their children
No, that is a wrong approach. To me, we deal with a world which is surrealistic. It's like a Hieronymus Bosch picture. A normal human being, a mind, cannot imagine that, and shouldn't, because it doesn't fall into categories of normal human behavior. End of story.
You were called to testify against a Ukrainian case.
Yes.
Who called you?
Well, other survivors knew the man, and actually one couple, my friend's wife's brother was shot by this man. So she gave my name to the Department of Justice. So they asked me, did you know the man? I said, no, but I was there. Do you know of him? Yes. Consequently, they came to a conclusion that they can utilize my testimony because I'm reasonably literate. And
who was the man?
The man was, I forgot the name of the lawyer of the Department of Justice.
No, who was the defendant?
The defendant is Osidach, was his name. Osidach. O-S-I-D-A-C-H.
And
he was the commanding officer of the Ukrainian police in Ravarusko.
Had you ever met him?
Personally not, but I knew of him because it was a small town, and the Jewish community was afraid of him, and rightly so.
And what happened at the trial?
At the trial, I was asked to identify the name and his function in the town. What was the Ukrainian police? What was his role in the town? And questions of general nature, which I have answered. And how did I get to Ravaruska and so forth? Having answered these questions, it became clear that I don't know the man personally, but I can say a great deal about the Ukrainian police, especially that I lived among the Ukrainians as a Ukrainian, and I have a very intimate knowledge of these people.
Were you questioned before the trial as well? By anyone?
Not in any way.
Or prepared for the trial?
No. Not in a way where I would assume that I'm being briefed. They try to determine who I am, what I know, and how to use me, but not what I should say or what the questions would be.
Was this gentleman or this man in the courtroom?
Yes.
And the where was this?
In Philadelphia.
And when?
I don't know, but I would assume, judging from other related experiences, because I advised at that time a bank in Philadelphia and a corporation, probably in the early 80s, 1980-81.
Did you have any eye contact with Mr.?
No. I was on the witness stand, and he was sitting there. I didn't even.
What did the defense lawyers ask you?
It was a Ukrainian born in the United States, and he asked me a silly question about the uniforms of the Ukrainian police, their weapons, what was their authority. He obviously was not very familiar with the subject, and the whole cross-examination, which was designed to point out, to destroy my credibility, was just backfired, that's all.
Were there many other people testifying?
Not while I was there.
And what was the outcome of this trial?
He has not reported that he was serving in the Ukrainian police and that he was a commanding officer of the Ukrainian police in Ravaruska. He has did not disclose it when in the usual questionnaire. So he obtained American citizenship illegally, and consequently, as a war criminal, he was stripped of it.
Was that done? Were you there when that was done?
No. There was eventually a verdict after other testimonies were taken.
Were you there when the verdict was
No,
read?
I wasn't interested. And eventually the court decided that he has violated the laws of the United States and will be stripped according to the legislation which was introduced by Elizabeth Holtzman and some other legislation on the subject of his citizenship. He appealed. The appeal, I think, went up to the Supreme Court and was rejected. But he died before being deported.
Were there any retributions from your testimony as a result of your testimony?
There were some threats on my life as well as threats on the judge's life.
Who was the judge?
I have no idea, and this was reported to me by the FBI.
Has there been any follow-up on this at all?
No.
Since then?
No.
I wanted to go back just a little bit to your relationship with the monks. Do you still have contact with any of them?
Yes, but most of them are dead. Most of them died over the years, and today I'm probably one or two survivors of the old group which existed when I was with them. But I have a very friendly relationship with the order, which still exists in Poland. They know of me, and my brother and I, within our means, make a contribution. They are rebuilding their monasteries. And as they say, that I am a member of the community. End of story.
Do you still meet with any of them?
Yes.
Are there any here in this country?
They come and go, yes. I still am contacted by them, yes. It's a strange relationship because they say they recognize me as a member of the community, although I'm Jewish, although I'm married, I have nothing to do. It's a part of their...
What do they call you?
The old ones, obviously, Roman. Never mind. After so many years, they still persist calling me that. Actually, the one group of the monks who was with me in the Carpathian Mountains later on found its way to Canada, to Woodstock, Ontario, and they lived there, visited them there.
Have you ever gone back?
No.
To any of the monasteries? Have you gone back to Lewin?
No. I keep in very close contact with this church, with the bishops and so forth. And they know of me, and occasionally I'm asking to participate in programs to commemorate the Metropolitan, yes, which I do with pleasure. I always am happy to testify to the greatness of the man, his assistance, his humanity, and his values. Jews in Poland considered him, if you know the expression, Lamed Wolf.
Yes, they hear him.
Yes.
He was Sadek. Your youngest son is a result of your present marriage.
That's right.
He is not considered, you don't consider him Jewish, or he doesn't consider himself Jewish. Is he involved in any way in knowing about your story? Or
very much so. He says he has two heritages, and he has very close relationship with my brothers. This is brothers.
With his brothers.
Sorry.
Why do you think you survived?
Accident. Second point. I was very close to Belzec, so I saw the destruction of the community, or the process of destruction of community, very early stage, and I realized that we all carry a death sentence because of the place I was and knowledge of the topography. Three, I was probably since childhood more aggressive and more enterprising. Aggressive, not in the negative sense. Three, because of my father's contact with the Metropolitan, who was my benefactor and his brother. And finally, because of resiliency, to submerge in monastic life of an Eastern monastic community. It's not an easy job.
Do you dream about that period?
About what?
That whole period. Beginning of the war.
No.
The monastic
Having fought in the Polish army and having spent 3 years in combat in Israel, I'm not pestered by these things at all. When I see the Lubavitcher with their mitzvah tanks around the ground, I find it very amusing, you see, and entertaining. When I see women rabbis in the synagogue, which I occasionally might visit, I see trampling on tradition, which caused me a lot of harm because I was chased in those days because I'm a Jew. So seeing people trampling on their own traditions makes me angry, but otherwise I am a neutral observer, as I have fought my battles. I won some, I lost some, as everybody else. I don't find my story unique or special. It's unique in only one point, that I was fortunate not to be in the clutches of the Germans for too long. So I was not exposed to this horror of dehumanization, as my friend Father Peters, who, because of his assistance to the Metropolitan and variety of activities which were anti-Nazi, ended in Dachau.
Why did you choose to tell your story now?
I didn't. You speak about the book?
No. Okay.
I got a phone call from the Shoah Institute, and a charming young lady, Victoria, who inquired whether I would like to testify. My answer was yes, because I wish to take every opportunity to create a record and a memory of those people who perished. Who's sitting here, I speak essentially for a community which was wiped out.
We are pretty much come to the end of your story. We are not going to end the interview. We want to show some of your documents and your pictures, but we are going to change our tape now. Dr. Kurt Lewin. Tell us about this picture, please, Mr. Lewin.
This is a picture of my father, Dr. Ezekiel Lewin, the last chief rabbi of the Jewish community of Lviv, taken in 1938.
How did you get the picture?
I had it with me all the time.
Okay. And this was taken in Lviv?
Yes. This is a picture of my mother, Rachel Rice Lewin. And this is a picture taken already in the first phase of the German occupation.
Do you know who took the picture?
My impression is the picture was taken for some document, probably in 1941.
And how did you get it?
I had it with me. This is my picture as a schoolboy in primary school, Polish primary school, and I wear the typical four-cornered hat or cap which students wore. This was taken in 1932 or 33.
Where?
In Lviv. This is a picture of my youngest brother, Leon, born in 1936, shot on the street by Obersturmführer Gzenek in front of my mother in probably November 1942.
In
Lviv, yes.
And how did you get it?
I had it with me. This is the Jewish synagogue, German Jewish synagogue in Katowice. It was the first rabbinical chair occupied by my father. He was a rabbi of this community for about 5 years before moving on to Lviv.
Do you remember this synagogue at all?
No. Well, 3 years when I left the city. This is a picture of my father, Dr. Ezekiel Lewin, the last chief rabbi of Lviv, taken in 1940 for a Soviet passport which every inhabitant had to have. It shows how the man has aged within a relatively short period of time, a year and a half. This was the time when he was systematically interrogated by the NKVD, and attempts were made to prompt him to leave his position as the chief rabbi of the city. This is a picture of Andrew Graf Szeptycki, Archbishop of Lviv and Metropolitan of Halic. He headed the Greek Catholic Church, which is a church of a Byzantine rite, however, in union with Rome. He was a man of enormous compassion and humanity, a friend of the Jews, issued a pastoral letter protesting the killing and alerting his flock not to participate actively or passively in the horror. The title of the pastoral letter is Thou Shall Not Kill.
What is the signature on that? Is it addressed to somebody?
No, it's just his name.
And how did you get the picture?
I got it after the war. And he also has organized and inspired people in his church to save over 200 Jews, men, women, and children who were sheltered in the monasteries and other institutions of this church. This is Clement Graf Szeptycki, brother of the Metropolitan and the general of the Studite order in which I lived during the war. He actually was responsible for sheltering and administration of this activity.
Where
of
did
Jews.
You get this picture?
I got it after the war. This is a picture of the monastery in which I lived in Carpathian Mountains on the borderline of Hungary. And these are the monks with whom I lived and the superior.
Are you on that picture?
No. I tried to avoid being photographed during that period. I could be recognized. The monastery, I lived there for a year. Very isolated place. The monastery was burned by the Germans and Hungarians retreating before the Red Army. The monks were deported to Germany.
Who took the picture?
This picture was taken by one of the visiting fathers who came there to spend a vacation.
And how did you get it?
I got it after the war from the monks. These are monks of the community in the Carpathian Mountains, student monks with whom I lived for a year. And this carriage is a means of transportation, namely it was pulled up the mountain by a little narrow gauge train, and we went down simply by the force of gravity, almost 60 kilometers to the main city.
What are they carting with them?
So whatever, food or God knows what we were carting. This is a diocesan priest working in the curia of the Metropolitan, Father Ivan Kotiw, K-O-T, like in Thomas I-W. He was the administrator of the sheltering of Jews, providing them with documents, and was responsible for arranging shelter for almost 200 souls. He was arrested by the NKVD in 1947, spent a number of years in labor camps, reappeared in Lithuania sometime in the 70s, and again disappeared, probably died in one of the labor camps.
How did you get this picture?
It was sent to me by friends of mine from Lviv, from Lvov.
Thank you.
Monks. This is a student, Father Johannes Peters, born in Westphalia, a German who joined the order in the 30s. He dedicated his life to this order and to serving the Archbishop and his ideas. He acted as a courier between the Metropolitan and the Papal Nuncio or Senigo in Berlin from 1941 to 42, and he also sheltered in two or three factories which he organized Jewish families in the cellar. He was arrested by the Gestapo and shipped to Dachau, where he survived the war.
Where was this picture taken?
That was taken after the war, because under certain circumstances which I described in my book, I had to defend him in an ecclesiastic court. Because he was accused by German bishops, because he told the German bishops publicly what he said all his life, that if they were decent people, they would be with him in Dachau. And if he would be a Nazi, he would be a bishop today, not a trout. Rather unusual man, to say the least. This is the senior superior of the Studites order, Father Marek or Marcos Tech. I smuggled him out of Poland disguised as a Jew. He was instrumental in saving me and many other Jews, because in the order he was administering the procurement of documents, shelter, and taking care of the individuals. He ended in Canada, and as he loved fishing, he served in British Columbia, and this is a picture taken during my last visit to British Columbia sometime in the early 70s. This is my picture taken shortly after the end of the war in the uniform of a Polish army officer.
And your name there?
I was Second Lieutenant Roman Matkowski.
And who took it? Who took the picture?
It was taken by somebody in the military unit because they had their own photographer and publicity man. This is my picture taken 5 years later. I was at that time a major in the Israeli army. And I have a sort of a decoration given to the individuals who participated in the defense of Jerusalem in 47-48. This is the first official document issued by the Labor Department, German Civilian Labor Department, to register Jews for forced labor. It might be interesting to know that it starts Der Jude, which means the Jew, and obviously the Star of David. This is the same document, registration of a Jew in Rawaruska by the Labor Department for identification purposes and temporary exclusion from deportation.
Where did you get this?
I had it.
You had it with you. Oh, you had all these documents with you all along?
No, they were in the archives of the Metropolitan. Before leaving Lwów, I picked them up and carried them with me to be able to identify myself. This is an interesting document issued by the German Civilian Administration. It's an identity document stating that I'm employed by the German firm collecting rags and scrap metal, and states at the end, officially with a stamp, that I am to be excluded from the deportation. And the last date of this document is 31st of July 1942, was not prolonged. This is an identity card with my picture in a cassock, identifying me as Roman Paul Mitka, a monk of the Studite order living in Lushki, which was one of the monasteries where I lived.
And what's the date on that?
The issuance date is August 1943. This is an identity document signed by the chief rabbi of the Polish army, David Kahane, who states that Matkowski Roman and Kurt Lewin are the same person, and stating that I am the son of Dr. Ezekiel Lewin, the chief rabbi of Lwów.
I want to
That's a very interesting document and a historical document. It's an identity card issued by the Jewish agency, its office in Rome, which was recognized by the British government. And on the reverse, you will find a visa permit to enter Palestine or Eretz Israel.
This was in 1946.
46, yes. A week before our departure from. So the upper is the visa, official visa. This is the dust cover and the book I've written while I was waiting for Aliyah Beit in Lido di Roma, near Rome. It was translated into Hebrew by Dov Sadan and published by Am Ovet in Israel in 1946.
And this is about your experiences?
This is about my experiences during the war, concentrating on the Holocaust and on my life at the Studites and the extraordinary saga of Metropolitan Sheptytsky and his brother. A variety of reasons and controversies surrounding the memory of the Metropolitan prompted me to write this book 3 years ago, A Journey Through Illusions, which describes the Holocaust, my life among the Studites, service in the Polish army, the survivors and their attempt to rebuild their lives, wandering through Europe, my stay in Israel, and encounter with the United States, and my work in Asia. The chapters not dealing with the war were introduced to provide my credentials and indicate the objectivity and my ability to portray something objectively and precisely. As a result of this book, Clement Graf Sheptytsky was recognized as a righteous by Yad Vashem, and so was Father Markostek, and through these two individuals, the Studite Order, which opened its doors to the persecuted Jews and saved them at the risk of their lives.
I want to thank you again, Mr. Lewin, for sharing your testimony with us, and wish you well.
Thank you, and I appreciate very much the opportunity to testify, and I wanted to thank you for helping me to bring the story out.